So my name is Dan. I'm from the Army Flying Museum. My role with the museum is as outreach and engagement officer. And that means I get to work with lots of different groups, lots of different people right across Hampshire and the Winchester area. So I'm going to show you how army flying has changed, and also how the museum has changed. So if you've been to the museum before, we had a massive refurbishment back in 2019, where we were closed for about 6 months or so, thanks to funding from the National Lottery Heritage Fund, where we refurbished the museum, and then we reopened with lots more brand new aircraft on display, and lots of things for people to see and do. And alongside that, we've had a massive outreach and engagement program as well. So I'm going to share my screen. So there we go. So the Museum of Army Flying was rebranded as the Army Flying Museum. And this is where we are, if you don't know where the museum is. So it's actually in between Southampton, Andover, Winchester and Salisbury, just outside a tiny little village called Middle Wallop. And Middle Wallop is one of three villages that make up a group of villages called the Wallop. So you have Over Wallop, Nether Wallop and Middle Wallop. And Middle Wallop is right next door to the Army Aviation Centre. So that's where some of the Army pilots go and do their training, or they might be finishing off their training as well. And then they get deployed to other bases around the country. So that's where the museum is. This is one of our aircraft outside the museum on the road between Andover and Salisbury. It faces out onto the A343 called the Beaver. And you can see it's in a camouflage pattern there. And we're going to see some of our personal stories at the museum, and also some of our aircraft, and also some of our really exciting community projects that we've been doing, and how the actual museum's changed itself over the past 2 years. So this is the museum on the outside. We've had a brand new super graphic put on the front, and you can see we've got the Apache, we've got balloons, we've got the Sopwith Pup, and a range of different aircraft that the Army have used right over the past 100 years also. So the outside of the museum looks very different. And this is what the museum looks like on the inside. So we've had the lottery funding to actually redisplay some of our aircraft, make it far more hands-on interactive. We've got a soundscape, which makes it as if some of those aircraft are taking off and kind of flying over your head as well. And we've got several new aircraft actually on display. So we have over 35 different planes, gliders and helicopters. And all of those have been used by the Army at some point throughout its history. So whether they are Army Air Corps, used by the glider pilot regiments of the Second World War, and then right back to the First World War, the Royal Flying Corps as well. So that's some of our aircraft there. These are two of our planes that we've got on display. The one on the right-hand side of your screen is the Beaver, another Beaver. And this one was actually used by the Army Air Corps out in Africa. And that's why it's kind of a sandy, a desert camouflage colour. And then we have the Islander, which is the plane about to take off up into the ceiling of the museum, and that was used to carry troops and equipment around mainly Eastern Europe. So that's the Islander and the Beaver there. Here's another close-up of the Islander and one of the Beaver. And then if you come to the museum, because we're right next door to the Aviation Centre, if you're very lucky, might get to see the Apaches take off and land, and some of the other aircraft that they use today. These are the Apaches, and these can fly over 150 miles an hour, and it takes two crew members, two pilots, to actually work and operate these aircraft. So that's the Apache. So as I was saying, our big lottery project is actually coming to a close at the end of September, and it's called Project Eagle, where we refurbished and reinterpreted and renovated the whole museum for new and existing audiences, so people who visited before and people who actually hadn't visited before as well. We had a big oral history project where we were collecting memories and experiences of current serving personnel, but also veterans, Army Air Corps veterans, and also other people connected with the Army Air Corps as well. We had our archive completely refitted, where we keep our photographic images, records, and artefacts as well, fit for purpose. Several new aircraft and a lot more personal stories put on display of those having been in the Army Air Corps and its predecessors. We've had brand new artefacts put on display as well. And alongside all of that, we've had a brand new volunteering program, education and learning program for schools to come and visit the museum, Brownie and Scout groups, families as well, and also our very successful outreach and engagement program, where we've actually been taking the museum out on the road to lots of different groups, doing lots of creative projects with them, and also holding pop-up museum events at different locations across Hampshire as well. So that's Project Eagle. And we've done loads of creative projects. So one of them was where we were inviting people to knit a mini parade of soldiers, as you can see there. We also last November invited people to help us knit and crochet medals, all inspired by our medal collection. And in the end, we had about 1,200 medals put on display in time for remembrance last year. And then we've been working with groups online as well. And some of them actually took part in a music project, which you'll see the results of at the end as well. So that's some of our projects there. And we go out to lots of groups where they're able to handle our replica objects and just gain a taste of what the museum has, but also how army flying has changed over the past 100 years. So that's the outreach programme. And so this is another photo of the Islander that we saw earlier. We also have the Scout, and this one, this particular Scout helicopter, was used to evacuate injured soldiers from different conflicts, but also attack enemy aircraft as well. And this one is actually part of our huge audio-visual show, Helicopters in Action, which shows how the attack helicopter was developed for the Army. So that's the Scout one there. This next one is the Cobra. And the Cobra, and you can see it's got kind of a funny face on the outside of it, was the predecessor of the Apache. So we've got the Cobra one there. And as well as those, we've got loads of hands-on things for people to try, families to try, adults to try as well at the museum. And this is one of my favourites. And this is where you can be an engineer, put all the bits of the engine back together in the right order, press the green button on the side and see if it revs up just like a real helicopter engine should do. So that's the museum. Now, army flying has a real mixed history, and it's made up of lots of different components, and there's lots of really weird and really unusual stories to kind of tie in with that as well. So army flying proper started back in the 1880s. And at that time, the army actually wanted to get its people up in the air. And one of the first ways they were doing that was by using balloons like this one in this photo from our collection. Now, these balloons were made out of animal intestines and animal innards, stretched over a wooden frame, and then filled with hydrogen gas. Now, underneath the balloon, there'd be a wicker basket. That basket would have room for two people to actually go up underneath the balloon, spend about a couple of hours spying and observing, gathering intelligence, being tethered to the ground or tied to the ground. And after a few hours of doing that, they'd wind the balloon back down, put it on a horse and cart, send it along to the next position, and then put it back up in the sky. And those men doing that job would look a bit like these men here with the funny moustaches, and their uniforms wouldn't be green, they would actually be bright red. So they're wearing bright red tunics right up underneath the balloons over 150 years ago. So that was the Royal Engineers, and the man responsible for getting the balloons up in the sky, as well as man lifting kites. So they were actually using huge kites where they would actually get the soldiers up on the kites and send them again up in the air, was this guy here, Captain James Templar. So that's Captain James Templar there. Then we come to the start of the 20th century, where you've got lots of people all over the world coming up with lots of weird and wonderful ways of getting people up in the air. You've got the Wright brothers coming up with their designs over in America. In this country, there are two people, mainly two people, who are coming up with their own designs and ways of trying to get the army up in the air. And one of them was this man here, Samuel Cody. And as well as designing planes, he actually designed airships for the army between Aldershot and Farnborough. And around there, he actually had these huge hangars, huge hangar buildings, where he was actually trying trying to build and design those types of things. So that's Samuel Cady there. We also have this man here, Captain Bertram Dixon, and Bertram was actually in the army, and he wanted to make the switch between from the balloons and the man lifting kites into the army having its own proper aviation section, and the idea of using planes and aircraft. So that is Captain Bertram Dixon there. That's another photo of Samuel Cody there. So in the First World War, he had everybody fighting down in the trenches, but some of them would undertake training to become pilots in the newly formed Royal Flying Corps. And the Flying Corps was the predecessor of what was to become the RAF. So the army got there first, and then some of those pilots actually then switched to the RAF or kept with the army and became glider pilots in the Second World War. So they're flying planes like the Sopwith Pup and the Camel. We've got an example of the Sopwith Pup at the museum. So here's a photo of it there. And this is our oldest aircraft that we actually have on display at the museum. And I'm going to show you a clip. So if I can bring this across. And this is our site manager talking about the Sopwith Pup.
Behind me is one of our prize exhibits. It's an original Sopwith Pup, originally built in 1916. It went to France and was later on used as a training aircraft in the UK, and would no doubt have probably served as a standby fighter for anti-air defences in the UK. Now, the interesting thing about the Sopwith Pup, its slightly larger brother was a Sopwith Camel, by the way, is the forward-firing machine gun, the Vickers machine gun you can see in front of the cockpit. And the reason I want to mention that is armament on First World War aircraft started from zero to machine guns in the course of 4 years. At the very start, an aircraft that was conducting reconnaissance or photography or observation type sorties would typically have a couple of pistols on board, or if they were feeling particularly aggressive, they might have a shotgun or a rifle. And this raises the theory that's called big sky, little bullet. If you're in an aircraft bouncing around in wind and turbulence, looking at another aircraft doing the same thing, and you take a shot at it with a revolver, the chances of hitting it are virtually zero. And so, gradually, the thought came, well, we must have machine guns. And with machine guns came true fighter aircraft. And in order to fight an aircraft properly, you need to be able to attack another machine accurately. And to do that would be to point the nose of your aircraft at that machine. Therefore, you needed a machine gun that would fire straight forward. And so you had to have a machine gun that was capable of firing through the propeller arc. Not an easy thing to do without shooting your propeller off. Without getting too technical about it, the rate of fire of the machine gun versus the rate of turn of the propeller can vary for all sorts of reasons. And therefore, some form of mechanism was sought to actually allow the bullet to pass through the propeller arc. And gradually, systems were evolved by both sides, on the Allied and on the German side, called interrupter mechanisms or synchronization mechanisms. And this allowed the pilot to press the button to fire the gun, but he didn't actually fire the gun. What he did was he released a button which allowed the engine to fire the gun. And the engine would fire the gun when the propeller was not in front of the muzzle of the machine gun. Now, up until then, some bright spark had fitted deflector plates onto the actual propeller. So where a bullet was likely to hit the propeller, which is just made of wood, remember, they fitted metal deflector blades. Now that would send any bullet that struck it off at certain directions and hopefully not straight back at the aircraft or the aircrew. So this was a development in aerial combat, and we're very proud to have the Sopwith Pup here at the Army Flying Museum.
Okay, so that's the Sopwith Pup, and that's our oldest aircraft there, and it would be flown by people like these men here. One of them in the top left-hand corner of your screen was Gilbert Insall, and he was awarded the Victoria Cross for actually shooting down 10 enemy aircraft in the First World War. And we have lots of stories, very similar stories of courage, bravery, and innovation, going right back to the days of the Royal Flying Corps. So we'd be flying the Sopwith Pups and the Sopwith Camel there. And they would look a bit like these men here, ready to, once they'd done their training, to go off and fly over the trenches. And then you move forward in time, and the Royal Flying Corps then merged into the Glider Pilot Regiment. And this was where they were using gliders to carry transport and transport equipment and troops into where they were needed. Now, at the museum, we have the largest collection of Allied gliders that were used, and copies of those that were used during the Second World War. One of them, we actually have lots of different bits from different versions of the Horsa gliders. Now, the Horsa was used to mainly carry troops over to D-Day and also for different operations and missions. And the Horser most gliders were made out of wood covered with a canvas skin, and they could actually fit about 25 to 30 soldiers. They would be piloted by two crew members in the front, and then they would be towed up into the air, let go whilst they when they were about 5 miles from where they needed to be, and then they would just rely on the wind to actually keep them up in the air and to get them into where they were needed. And sometimes the crew members or the glider pilots would write messages on the outside in the hope that the German soldiers might look up into the sky and see what they had actually written on the front. So I'm now going to play a clip about the Horser glider, and we have our library assistant Henry, who's actually going to tell us about the Horser glider.
The aircraft situated behind me is a Horser glider used by the Glider Pilot Regiment during the Second World War. Here in the museum, we hold three different Horsers. As well as the Horser behind me, we also have the only surviving cockpit of a Mark I Horser and a larger Horser made up of both Mark I and Mark II parts. These remains behind me, however, are a Mark II Horser. It can be identified as such, as the Mark II Horser had a hinged cockpit or nose door, meaning that it could swing open to allow for easier loading. The Mark I, meanwhile, had a side door for loading. Both types of glider could be unloaded by removing the tail section. If you look in the cockpit of the Horser, you can see that the glider pilot sat side by side when flying. The aircraft had dual controls, which meant that it could be flown from either seat. Behind the pilots, in the main body of the Horser, around 28 fully equipped soldiers could fit in. The Horser glider was built by Airspeed Limited and was constructed from 30 separate sections. These were assembled by civilian staff who worked for the Ministry of Aircraft Production. Over 3,600 Horser gliders were built for the British Airborne Forces during the Second World War. Of these, over 1,500 were actually flown on operations. A question which could be asked about the gliders is, why were they used? Well, there were a number of advantages to using military gliders. One of the most important is that they were engineless, so they had the ability to silently approach a target, ensuring stealth and maintaining the element of surprise. They also had the capability to carry and deliver an organised force which could be ready for instant use upon landing. A key aspect of the glider is that it is engineless. However, this meant that in order to reach its destination, it needed to be towed by aeroplanes. Halifax, Albemarle, Stirling and Dakota aircraft were all used as Horser tugs. One of the most important operations in which Horser gliders were used was in the coup de main assault on the bridges over the River Orne and the Caen Canal. This was a part of Operation Tonga, and if it had not been successful, then the entire Allied invasion of Normandy on the 6th of June 1944 could well have ended in disaster. During the operation, six Horsers landed next to two bridges, three landing at each. The success of the landings allowed the Allied troops they carried to disembark and quickly capture the bridges. It really was an astonishing achievement, and it would not have been possible were it not for the Horser glider. In fact, the landings were so impressive that Air Chief Marshal Mallory described the coup de main assault as one of the most outstanding flying achievements of the war.
Okay, so that's the gliders there. And as I said, we have the largest collection of Allied examples of Allied gliders actually on display at the museum. So that's the horse there. And they'd be towed up into the sky, let go, and then they glide into where they were needed. Now, as well as the gliders, they were coming up with lots of weird and wonderful ways of getting people and the soldiers up in the air. And one of them was this thing here, and you might think, what on earth is that? And this is what we call a rotor chute. And the rotor chute was basically a ski. You've got the ski at the bottom, got a seat for the soldier, and a tail fin and a rotor blade at the top. And these were almost like mini helicopters. And this meant that they could actually drop these soldiers into kind of cold and mountainous terrain, should I say, let them go. They would hover in, go down the side of the mountain or the hill, and then they could kind of go off and attack the enemy. So we actually have an example on loan to the museum, which is actually on display at the museum. So that is the rotor chute there. Now, as well as those, they're trying to trick and fool the German troops into thinking we have more soldiers invading and landing, especially at D-Day. And one of the ways they did that was by using these things here. And this is called a Rupert, or a dummy parachutist. It was given the nickname Rupert because Rupert was a derogatory nickname that soldiers would give to their higher ranking officers. So kind of chucking the officers out of the gliders, as it were. And these would be made out of vegetable sacks, potato sacks, stuff with wadding and sawdust. On the back, they would have their own silk parachute. On the front, they would sew onto them mini firecrackers, and then what they would do is set them alight, chuck them out the side of the glider, and from the ground it would sound and look as if more soldiers were invading from the sky at a distance. Now, over 200 of these were used at D-Day, and by using them at D-Day as part of Operation Titanic, they actually fooled nearly an entire German battalion of soldiers and thinking that some of our soldiers were landing where they actually were. So that is the Rupert. Now, we actually have one on display at the museum. And so the one we actually have on display at the museum was found in the back of somebody's garden shed here in England back in 2013. And it remains a mystery to this day how on earth that one actually survived and made its own way back across the channel and back into England and into that person's garden shed. Because when they landed on the ground, they were supposed to burn up and leave no trace. Yet that one, with a couple of others, actually survived. Now, it actually featured on the quiz programme QI about 5 years ago. And here it is, as demonstrated by Sandy Toxic.
A list here, okay, of the Christian names of the first 200 parachutists to land in Normandy on D-Day. I'd like you to give me the name of any of them.
Their Christian name?
Any Christian name. Yes,
from Vladimir. One of
the, Vladimir, we're going to start with.
Yes.
Another first name?
Mordechai.
Mordechai? Well, choices in here.
John, Dave, William.
Enid.
Alan. Are you suggesting that it's Alan?
They were dummy people.
They were dummy people. Allied parachutists into Normandy consisted of 200 dummies, six men, some gramophones and a pigeon.
That's the good night.
It's the classic. Yes, the absolute classic. The 200 dummies were a diversionary tactic. Sure. The six men were SAS troops. I like this. They played battle noises on gramophones to divert the Germans from the real airdrops, which were going on elsewhere. And the pigeon was a carrier strapped to the very first man to land. So the first soldier to land was called Norman Poole. I think they thought Normandy. Norman, let's have Norman. fact, the very first ones were 200 dummies, and they were all called Rupert. Because British soldiers often refer to their officers as Ruperts. They were only 2 foot 9 inches tall, but from the ground they would have looked full size. So I've got helmets for you. If you wouldn't mind, just stick those on there.
Just following orders.
Yeah. Because we're going to show you from the ground what the parachute drop would have looked like. It would have looked like this. You didn't need the helmets, but then it is possible that you would need them.
I needed it, yeah.
So those are replicas, obviously, of Rupert's. They contained firecrackers so that when they landed, it sounded like they were firing.
This one is anatomically correct.
They distracted nearly a full German division. And in 2013, a Rupert was discovered in a garden shed in the UK. And nobody knows how he got back. We have a real one here, which comes from the Museum of Army Flying in Middle Wallop. Wow. Don't you love this country? We have a place called Middle Wallop. It is a company.
So that is the Rupert there. And then after the Second World War, the glider pilots, if they were glider pilots and they wanted to carry on, something called the Royal Air Observation Post Squadron was formed. So there were lots of different squadrons based across the country. And those were where the Royal Artillery were working with pilots up in the air. And then on the 1st of September 1957, the Army Air Corps proper actually was formed properly. So then the Army had its own aviation wing, as it were. Now, for a while, if you were a pilot in the Army Air Corps, in the newly formed Army Air Corps, you might be called Teeny Weeny Airways. And that nickname was given to them by pilots in the RAF because of the size and number of aircraft that they had in comparison to the RAF. Now, this clip here is from Pathé News, and it's from the early 1960s. It's of an air demonstration at Mid Wallop, and it's actually called Teeny Weeny Airways. Now, keep a lookout for the pretend tiger, and all will become.
Dancing tadpoles. That might be the perfect description of these Skeeter helicopters, but they're part of Teeny Weeny Airways, the affectionate title given to the Army Air Corps. Their annual show isn't a Farnborough by any stretch of the imagination, but as a day out for Mum, Dad and the kids, it scores every time. Fancy a tiger hunt, old boy? Oh, none of that bouncing about in a Jeep. Just sit back and enjoy the armchair comfort of a 100-mile-an-hour Alouette. There's no getting away from it, not for the tiger anyway, that this is the latest in safari techniques. Join the army and squad, olé! We'll admit they haven't quite mastered the Spanish style, but then this is no ordinary bull. This slapstick view of Britain's soldier pilots is light relief from their hazardous work all over the world, including the rescue of victims trapped by fire, flood and snow. They can tackle many tasks, but when it comes to speed, it's doubtful if they've got the measure of world...
So that's the newly formed Army Air Corps doing a flying demonstration at Middle Wallop there. And then this next one, again from Pathé News, is actually called Flying Pongos. Now, Pongo was a nickname for soldiers, and these happen to be flying soldiers or flying Pongos. So if I press play.
Pongos, that's one of the names the RAF types call the army, their earthbound comrades in arms. But just to confuse the issue, these are flying Pongos. They're quick to point out that the army has been flying longer than the Air Force. These boys are in the Army Air Corps. Their grandfathers were in the Royal Flying Corps. And as likely as not, their dads were hedgehopping as Air OPs somewhere in the middle. Oh yes, and that's where we are, the Army Air Corps Center at Middle Wallop. talking of AeroPs, artillery spotting by light aircraft, World War II gunners and infantrymen will remember the familiar Oster, a later mark but still the same job and still flown by army officers. Unarmed, they defend themselves by dodging. They're so maneuverable, an enemy fighter can't pin them down. The Army Air Corps, formed in 1957 to take over all army flying, has quite a variety of aircraft. And brother, can they fly them?
So that was the newly formed Army Air Corps. Now today, the Army Air Corps have over 2,000 pilots based across the country and also around the world as well. And once they've passed all their training, they're ordered the Blue Beret. And on that Blue Beret is the eagle. And the eagle is the symbol of the Army Air Corps. Now, Prince Harry, he was actually a Army Air Corps pilot, and he did several tours out in Afghanistan as an Apache pilot, so flying the Apache like this. And we actually have a clip of him. See if you can spot him in the background making a cup of tea in the tent in Afghanistan.
I'm Ash. I'm an Apache helicopter pilot of 662 Squadron, 3 Regiment Army Air Corps, currently serving on 24-hour operations in Afghanistan. Okay, we cover four duties while we're out in Afghanistan. They are VHR day, VHR night, we have duty crew and tasking. So the VHR is very high readiness, where we can be called out to anything from casualty evacuations to troops in contact to supporting high-value targets. Come in to take over on VHR, and we'll come in some period of time before we're due to take over. We'll carry out a brief as a flight where we'll get the latest intelligence, operations being carried out that day in the area, and then we'll also discuss our standard operating procedures as a flight. We'll then move to the aircraft with the offcoming VHR crew. We'll do a period of swapping the kit over in the aircraft, and then myself and my other pilot will then walk around the aircraft to ensure that it's serviceable to fly for that day. Once that's complete, we'll then come back to the tent, where we're basically on 15 minutes notice to move by day, 30 minutes notice to move by night. We have a telephone inside, so we'll just basically sit inside that tent waiting for the phone call. So we have long periods of not a lot happening, followed by really short bursts of excitement of running to the aircraft, knowing that you're going out to assist someone and to provide a service to someone out on the ground that requires your help at that time. And it's quite a satisfying feeling knowing that you're providing that for someone. Tasking, we carry out pre-planned operations throughout the area, which are side by side with the ground forces, as well as the other helicopters in the Joint Aviation Group in Afghanistan. So we'll go out with Chinooks to carry out infill of troops into areas and exfil of troops, and then we'll carry out the overwatch of the troops while they're on the ground as well during their operations. So duty crew is a period where we work directly with our REMI engineers. We also work with the ground crew during the duty crew period, and throughout our period actually out here they work very closely with us. So they carry out all our gun and missile rocket uploads, downloads. They carry out the refueling on the helicopters, and they also move the aircraft around. The job we're doing out here in Afghanistan has a really good effect. It gives the guys on the ground that warm, fuzzy feeling that they can carry out their job, knowing that if anything goes wrong, we're there to support them. It's a really good feeling to know that you're doing something out here that is helping the people out there doing the job on the ground.
Okay, so that's the role of the modern Army Air Corps, and hopefully you spotted Prince Harry in the back of shop making everybody a nice cup of tea as well. And we have lots of, thousands upon thousands of images, both on display at the museum, but also in our archive collection as well, such as this one here of a pilot hugging a helicopter, as you do. And also the pilots kind of mucking about on the airfield, different pets and things like that. But we also have a link to this person, Tim Peake. And I'm going to show you a clip of our link to Tim Peake. So I'll
Is this the peak of our collection? Well, I'm sure that Major Timothy Peake would say so, seeing as this is the polo shirt worn by him whilst in space. Tim was the first British astronaut to serve in the European Space Agency and spent a total of 6 months at the International Space Station. However, before he became an astronaut, Tim served for 17 years in the Army Air Corps. He gained his Army flying wings in 1994 and served on operations in the Balkans and Afghanistan. He also served as a test pilot for the Apache helicopter. During his time in the Air Corps, Tim logged over 3,000 hours flying on more than 30 fixed-wing aircraft and helicopters. This included the Dakota and the Hawk. Not long after leaving the Army Air Corps, Tim was selected to be an astronaut for the European Space Agency in May 2009. Soon after his selection, he kindly came into the museum and was interviewed by some schoolchildren about what he was hoping for his time as an astronaut.
This is the 40th anniversary of man walking on the moon. But if you were the first Brit on the moon, what would you do when you got up there?
I think if I had the opportunity, it would just be nice to look back and just reflect and to view the Earth from the moon. I think must be the most incredible and the most beautiful sight that you could possibly see. I think with all of these things, though, there's on missions, your time that you have to yourself is probably very short, and everything is very structured and on timelines and routine. So it's one of those things that I think you'll just have to build in perhaps a few seconds here or there, or a minute if you could, just to reflect on the situation and enjoy it for yourself.
It would not be until December 2015, though, that Tim launched for the International Space Station. During his time at the space station, he undertook numerous tasks. These included piloting a rover across simulated Mars terrain, taking part in over 250 scientific experiments, helping to dock two spacecraft at the space station, and even taking part in a spacewalk in order to fix the space station's power supply. Upon his return, Tim very kindly donated this unwashed and sweaty polo shirt to the museum, and it has since taken up an important space in the museum's collection.
Okay, so as you can see, we have the Omni flying has changed right from the days of the Royal Engineers and their balloons and kites through the First World War, using the Sopwith pups and the Sopwith camels over the trenches, to the glider pilot regiment of the Second World War, using the different types of gliders, the air observation posts after the Second World War, right through to the modern Army Air Corps, and at least one Army Air Corps pilot actually going onto the International Space Station. And we have Tim's unwashed polo shirt, as Henry says, on display at the museum. So the Army Air Corps do a whole range of different jobs, just like the regular army. So they fly the Apaches and the Wildcats. They're regular soldiers as well. And then they have people making sure that the helicopters have enough fuel and weapons. And they also have people like Sergeant Margaret Welton here, who makes sure that the helicopters are actually working correctly and properly. And here she is talking about the job she does.
I am an aircraft technician, supervising other ranks on this aircraft to be able to maintain it and to give the pilots serviceable aircraft for their missions and tasks. In 15 years, I have managed to come from not having a clue about the Army to joining the Army and joining aeronautical engineering trade, having finished university this year to have a first class degree in engineering and management studies, So that's quite an achievement, and the army helped make that happen. And for those who will be carrying this education out in the future, I would say to you, go for it.
So so the Army Air Corps do a whole range of jobs. In their past, they've had lots of different pets and mascots. And you can see here, here's a gibbon who actually adopted a group of pilots when they were stationed out in Malaysia. We also have a puppy in a cockpit of a plane there. So they've had lots of different pets and mascots and that kind of thing. The museum, as I said earlier on, is open 7 days a week. Come and see us. But we're also doing lots of really, really exciting events, both in person, but also online, such as our lockdown lectures, which are free to attend online. Our next one, or next two, are actually coming up on the 20th of September between at 7 o'clock, which is covers 100 years of fixed wing flying. So talking about the change in from the Royal Flying Corps, the glider pilot regiment, through to the air observation post and some of the training aircraft that the army use today. We also have on the 25th of September the T. Lawrence Symposium, which is taking place throughout the day online, and it's going to be based at Calshot as well. And then we also have our free in-person talk all about Operation Market Garden on the 17th of September at the museum, which is going to be free to attend. And then we have a whole range of events happening at the museum as well, such as our Living History Saturday on the 2nd of October with the Wiltshire History Living History Group. October half term sees our Brilliant Birds Week, lots of make and take craft activities for families to come along to. Then we have on the 21st of November, a bit further ahead, our Aircraft Enthusiast Fair and Model Show, a whole range of different aircraft model makers coming along and showing what they've been making and selling those. And then on the 11th of December, we have our Christmas Carol Concert with the Army Medical Service Band, and they will be holding or performing in our Christmas Carol Concert. So as well as all those events, we're doing lots of big community projects, such as these Rupert's here, which were made by over 100 mini Rupert's were made by community groups just before the museum reopened after our big refurbishment in 2019. Then we had over 600 mini helicopters made and knitted, sent in from all over the country, which are currently on display at the museum for people to see. And they're all sent in from people right across the country throughout the second lockdown, and as far away as Canada and New Zealand. Then we've been working with lots of sewers and crafters and embroidery enthusiasts, and they've been making their own army flying history inspired garments. They're currently on display at Fareham Library, and they're going to be touring lots of different libraries and venues over the next few months and actually into next year as well. And then some of those people who made the first lot of garments actually wanted to carry on sewing for the museum, which is fantastic. And they repurposed ex-army surplus garments and kits and turned them into high-end fashion garments. So you have lots and lots of very different and very unusual creations currently on display at the museum. And then they're going to go on a camouflage couture tour of libraries and museums. So they will be going to Ringwood and Fordingbridge Libraries in October and November. going to Tidworth Library from December to January, and then to Salisbury Library from the 6th of January to the end of January next year, then on to Totton Library near Southampton, then to Romsey from the 2nd of March to the 29th of April next year. And then finally, they will be going to the Rifles Berkshire and Wiltshire Museum in Salisbury next May to the end of June next year. And then they will fly back into the museum. And then alongside that, we're inviting lots of different community groups to help us make some flying art banners. So these banners will be made made by different groups right across the area, right across Winchester and the Hampshire area, all inspired by our different aircraft. And they'll be made by these groups. They go on display at the museum next year, and then they will tour local venues and with our pop-up museum events that we do, and then they will be given back to the group. Now, one last project that we did during January to March this year was we worked with a theatre company, Historical Hussars, who are based in Winchester. And they worked with members of Winchester Military Wise Choir, Middle Wallop Community Choir, Military Wise Choir, and Salisbury Community Choir. They learned and rehearsed a song all inspired by the stories and the history of the glider pilot regiment and missions that they undertook. And they learnt the song and then rehearsed it, sent in their videos, and then they would put all together, and this is the final performance.
In the year 1940, Churchill decreed, it's 5,000 banners that this country needs. But it wasn't just men they needed to enlist. They needed an aircraft to fly on a wisp. What a plan, it was puzzling, a new way to fight. But the boys on the ground, they were eager for flight. If they'd glided before, or they wanted to learn, they were signed up to help the war tides turn. They flew up, way up in the sky. The boys in the gliders caused quite a surprise. They went up, way up in the sky, like eagles through mountains they'd silently glide. Strange and rock, they headed things up. The plan for them, a half full cup. They were the men for the job, as they'd flown before. Over the trenches of the First World War, in the cold and the rain, it wasn't much fun. But they did what they had to push back the Hun. With the war raging on, supplies they got short. So they borrowed some gliders, well borrowed of sorts, to help them fly up, way up in the sky. The boys in the gliders caused quite a surprise. They went up, way up in the sky, like eagles through mountains they'd silently glide. With the train complete, there was a mission in sight. The gliders went in under the cover of night. This was the moment that D-Day did start. And us boys in red berets, a critical part, they landed nearby. Gliders six, then with power and passion took Pegasus Bridge. The call it went out, it said ham and jam. The bridges were captured, all gone to plan. Because they'd flown up, way up in the sky. The boys in the gliders took them by surprise. They went up, way up in the sky, like eagles. Silently glide. They went up,
Okay, so that was the Music Makers project that we did with a whole range of community choirs. And we have lots of ways people can support us by visiting the museum. You can adopt an aircraft as well, and all the details are on our website. And we have museum membership, which means that you can come back to the museum as many times as you wish to. You can donate to our Fly High Appeal, and also you can sponsor one of our trustees, Colonel Paul Edwards, who is actually trying to climb Mount Kilimanjaro next year, pending travel restrictions. So I'd like to say a big thank you. I found that really interesting and fun. And I'm going to now stop sharing my screen and hand that back to Becky. So thank you very much.
That was just fantastic. Thank you so much, Dan. I really enjoyed that. And the use of videos was just brilliant. There were some of those, especially those Pathé ones, they were quite different. I'm slightly worried about the tiger, but there you go. So that is really good. I can't see any questions yet, so I'm going to sneak in one of mine. Is, are your helicopters completely different to what's used by the Navy and by the RAF? Does each military sort of have their own type of helicopter, or are there similarities?
So that's a good question, actually. The Army primarily use the Apache, but also they use the Wildcat, which is a slightly smaller helicopter. But the Fleet Air Arm of the Navy, they also use the Wildcat as well. And the RAF primarily use the Chinook. But the idea is that everybody kind of works together. So in the clip of them being out in Afghanistan, you saw the Chinook kind of landing the troops down on the ground. Uh-huh. So the RAF supporting the army with troops on the ground. But then the Apaches are kind of like the eyes of the army up in the air. So they would kind of be supporting each other, kind of RAF to army or army to RAF. So they do use similar aircraft, but such as the Wildcat, but the Apache is very different to what the RAF uses and things like that.
Okay, thank you for that. Does anybody else have any more questions? Do put them into chat or in the Q&A.
Becky, perhaps I can butt in and ask one while you're waiting for the chat. Dan, you showed us a picture of the one of the static balloons that was used for observation in the early days of the Army Air Corps. Weren't they a sitting duck for the enemy, or did the enemy just not have weapons that could reach them?
That's a good question. So the balloons would be kind of behind the front line, and they would be used for observation and intelligence, and they would almost sometimes they'd be sitting ducks, but there weren't actually very many times where they actually got shot down. Most of the injured personnel that were using balloons actually were injured from very rare accidents, from kind of experimenting with the balloons. And to make the situation worse, they were wearing red tunics, so they would be kind of fairly easy to spot, but then they would be quite a long distance from the front line, really. So that's the way they kind of got around it.
Thank you.
There is a question now for you, Dan, in the chat from a member of the audience who's asking, why doesn't the AAC operate Chinooks?
That's a really good question. I don't know the answer to that, but all I do know is that the Army Air Corps, I think, favour the Apache, certainly because, and kind of the Cobra before it, because they're very, very flexible and adaptable to what they need them to do, really. So they can kind of get into where they need to be very, very quickly and get out of there as well, and then kind of provide the eyes in the sky for the troops down on the ground, and also kind of see ahead and gather information about the enemy as well. So it's more kind of supporting rather than firing at a last resort, I suppose. Whereas the Chinooks are mainly used for kind of transporting big bits of equipment, doing kind of airlifts and things like that. So yeah, that's one of the main reasons. There's probably more that I don't know about.
Thank you. That's really helpful, Dan. We've got two more questions, and then I'm aware of time, so we'll probably have to finish. But we've got two more. One from John. How long was the Cobra operated by the Air Corps?
Oh, that's really testing my knowledge. I don't know the answer to that. The Apache was introduced in the late 90s, something like that. And then the Cobra is more in the 80s, I think. I'd have to look up.
You're being tested this afternoon. You weren't expecting that, were you? Okay, and our final question before I allow the audience to go is, Bernadette has asked about air displays and the air displays that you do at the museum. She's asking if there's been any, and I think you do them, don't you? So do you want to talk about your air displays?
Yeah, so we have a group of volunteers called the Historic Army Air Flight, and mainly Fridays and Saturdays throughout the summer, and when the weather's good, they operate some of the same aircraft that we have in the museum, and they kind of do demonstrations, and they might take people up out on the airfield. So that's what they do, and they're the Historic Army Air Flight. And also, in July this year, we held our first big event called Wallop Wheels and Wings. And that was a big fundraising event for the museum. But we also had lots of aircraft fly in to the airfield. And then we closed the airfield, and then people, visitors, could actually go out and get up close to the aircraft that flew in, especially for that day. And it was so popular that we're running it again on the 2nd of July next year. So Wallop Wheels and Wings 2022 will be happening, and we'll have a number of aircraft fly in for that day. So the air displays, the aircraft movements, the Army Air Corps do depend on what they're doing, basically, if they're kind of in the area. The Historic Army Air Flight, they tend to kind of fly on Fridays and at weekends, and they fly. They might do a bit of flying just to test the engines, keep the engines of the planes that they've got and helicopters. Fantastic. They've got as well.
So it sounds like we've all got to come to you in the summer, definitely on the 2nd of July next year, but generally at weekends. It just sounds fantastic. That's been wonderful, Dan. I can't see any more questions coming up, so I'm going to say thank you to you, and also thank you to our